Good morning and welcome to the 24th meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee, and I remind all members and witnesses to ensure their devices are on silent. And today, Emma Roddick, MSP, will be joining us online. And first, I would like to welcome Fulton MacGregor to his first meeting as a member of the committee. And our first item of business today is to invite him to declare any relevant interest.
Thank you, Convener. No relevant interest to declare. However, I do want to put on record, for the purposes, of course, of this committee, that I was a local authority councillor in North Lanarkshire Council between 2012 and 2016.
Thanks very much, and welcome to the committee. The second item of our agenda is to decide whether to take item 5 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. Thanks. The next item on our agenda is to take evidence on the Scottish Local Authorities Remuneration Committee, SLARC, recommendations for councillors' remuneration and expenses from two panels of witnesses. And we're joined on our first panel in the room by Jane O'Donnell, who's the Chief Executive at COSLA. And joining us in person are two former members of the Scottish Local Authorities Remuneration Committee, SLARC, David Heaney and Martin McElroy. And we're also joined online by Angela Leach, CBE, who's the former convener of SLARC. And I welcome the witnesses to the meeting, and I'd like to invite Angela and Jane to begin by making short opening statements. Angela. Oh, she looks frozen.
Oh, here we go. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair, and thank you for the opportunity to come back to the committee to discuss the findings that we set out in the SLARC report earlier this year. As members are aware, I wrote to the Cabinet Secretary following publication of the Government's response to our recommendations, and I did that having discussed our response with my colleagues, two of whom are in the room with you today. Firstly, I have to say that we definitely welcome the Scottish Government's broad acceptance of the recommendations as set out in our report. There are, however, three issues that SLARC would like to bring to your attention and perhaps have a bit of a discussion about today. First of all, the timing of the implementation of our recommendations. Secondly, the delegation of funding responsibility solely to local government. And thirdly, the importance of the role that the national sphere of governance in Scotland plays in the minds of the Scottish people when advocating for local government. So, very briefly, the timing. I think I set out in the letter fairly extensively, so I don't intend to go over that again. But we did work throughout 23 and into 24 on the understanding that the necessary statutory instruments or regulations could be affected to allow implementation of anything that we would propose and was accepted in the year 24-25. It was subsequently later, in fact, very late in the calendar year, we were advised that that wouldn't be the case. Nevertheless, given that retrospective application is always an option, we felt it was important to set out the fact that these, both the banding changes as well as the increase to the councillor's remuneration, could be implemented this year. And that was on the basis that it was 2011 when the last SLARC report was presented, and there were very few of those recommendations that were approved at that particular point in time. The second point is on funding, and I think it is important that the committee is aware of the work of SLARC throughout our commission as far as affordability was concerned. It was part of our remit, again, I've set that out in our letter, and we broke down in quite a lot of detail just to demonstrate the consideration that we'd given to that. We've highlighted what it would be at a national level, and we've also broken it down by local authority. The amounts are quite modest, again, given the timescale between this review and the last review. And this isn't a pay increase as such. This isn't an annual increase. This is a fundamental reassessment of the role of local councillors within local authorities. So that's really why we've spent such a lot of time on that. And it did then come as a bit of a surprise to the committee that the total responsibility for finding that funding would come from existing local government funding. Had we been aware of that, and it certainly wasn't our understanding, we would have made a recommendation that this was, at the very least, a shared approach that was adopted. And finally, I think that there are a number of recommendations that the Scottish Government, while acknowledging and accepting, have indicated that it would be the responsibility of COSLA and local authorities to take forward and implement. I think that we gathered evidence, and my two colleagues that are in the room will certainly be able to reinforce this in any questions, that the view is that across the electorate that this has to be a joint endeavour. I think if we're serious of removing barriers and reinforcing the importance of that this frontline level of democracy, then not leaving it solely to local authorities is really, really important, and a demonstration of the value that the government places on this sphere of government is really important. You know, I acknowledge that there are several MSPs who started out their political careers in local government and will understand the challenges that those people face. I think that our view is that while it is important that we acknowledge that finance is challenging in the current circumstances, but so is it that we have this imbalance in representation when local councillors are making decisions, determining services within these very tight constraints, when they in many occasions, they're not broadly representative of the communities that they serve. So we would ask the committee to consider both our letter and our representation today in considering any further actions that the government might take in response to our report. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Angela. And now, Jane.
Thank you, convener, and thank you to the committee for inviting COSLA here today. As Angela Leach noted, the invitation follows recent correspondence between the SLARC committee, between COSLA and the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Local Government, which I think you're aware of. The way we recognise the value of our councillors in Scotland is a matter of great importance, not only to COSLA and to the 1,267 people in our communities who act as our councillors, but also to the communities that they serve. We all want councils that are truly representative of the people that they represent. This is essential to our democracy, not only for the effective running of the country, but also for the trust and the belief that people have in it to deliver improved outcomes and quality of life for everyone. But we know that not everyone in our country feels able to stand as a councillor, or even more significantly, can remain as a councillor due to the low rate of remuneration for the role. You've heard previously from our colleagues in SLARC and probably here today about the huge body of evidence that they collated and considered before they made their recommendations. COSLA's presidential team and myself have been around the country visiting councils. We're about halfway through, and I've been speaking to councillors across the country at that point. We've heard firsthand of the barriers that people are facing when they want to stand for election to represent their communities. COSLA are committed to removing barriers to anyone who wants to be a councillor, whether that's through the party political system or those who choose to stand as an independent councillor, of which there are many. We have a barriers to elected office group in COSLA, and we put resource into that, and it comprises a more diverse range of people who are councillors and can give us their lived experience. And their experience is at the heart of the COSLA submission to the committee. From this work and reflected in the findings of the SLARC committee, we know a key barrier to women, to people with disabilities, to single parents, to young people, and to those from ethnic minority backgrounds to being a councillor is the level of remuneration, which currently does not provide a real living wage and therefore blocks unrepresented people from being a key voice in our democratic decision-making bodies. It's vital to acknowledge that no one is disputing that fact from the evidence that's been brought forward, and we all accept and recognise that that is the case. It was the causal view at the outset of the start of the most recent SLARC committee inception that a lack of understanding about the role of counsellor may significantly hinder the calls for improved terms and conditions. The remit of SLARC directly addressed that point, and we were pleased to see that, asking if the role of a counsellor has changed, to which the committee provided the wealth of evidence I previously mentioned, demonstrating the adding complexities of the role in 2024, including expectations around partnership working, an increased role in scrutiny and challenge, and responsibilities around their strategic input. SLARC found on average in 2023 that councillors spend about 26 hours a week on the formal aspects of their roles and then take on additional responsibilities as councillors, which means even more hours. The remuneration proposed by SLARC in their report is an appropriate increase reflective of the added complexity. Causal are clear that our vision is to ensure that everyone can live well in our communities. We have a long-held ambition to strengthen local democracy, and we want to see more political power at a level closest to our communities. This is reflected in our shared working with the Scottish Government on the Local Governance Review and our shared priority to deliver sustainable services through public service reform. Why do I mention this? Because we can only do that by ensuring that our elected members at both national and local level are as diverse as our communities, reflecting the views and the lived experience of the people they're there to serve. As financial restrictions hit our services, it's vital the people who scrutinise and ultimately make the decisions on the proposals reflect the people they represent. The committee are already aware the 2011 SLARC recommendations were never implemented. Back in 2011, the reason given then was a lack of resources. If we believe in democracy, then we cannot allow another set of recommendations to go unrealised. We do acknowledge the Cabinet Secretary's committed to implementing several of the recommendations, but leaving the cost of the recommendations to local government budgets would result in limited implementation of the recommendations and an unacceptable pitting of frontline services and colleagues against the cost of democracy. COSLA understands the reasons for the delay for the report and the ministerial response, but we want to stress the importance that this work is prioritised going forward. We want to see the implementation of these recommendations. All 32 COSLA leaders have accepted the recommendations in principle, and stress the importance that any uplift is backdated to April 2024. For our part in COSLA, the Barriers to Elected Office Interest Group have already begun work to consider the implementations which the committee decided were a matter for COSLA to take on. The group note the varying legislative, financial and capacity challenges involved in the implementation, and we know this will result in different timelines for each recommendation, but we remain committed to delivering them. I would just finish by re-emphasising that the Independent Scottish Local Authority Remuneration Committee was re-established in April last year in response to a joint commitment from COSLA and Scottish Government that terms and conditions truly reflect the responsibilities of a modern-day councillor. Being a modern-day councillor must be open to everyone in Scotland and not just to those that can afford to do so. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that, Jane. It's good to kind of hear COSLA's perspective there. We've got a number of questions, and actually both of you have possibly touched in on some of the kind of illuminated and given us some of the answers, but I think we want to dig in a little bit further. Angela, I just want to come to you initially, because you said in your opening statement that if SLARC had understood, I think I'm going to paraphrase you maybe badly, but if SLARC had understood the government's response, then you would have made a recommendation on a shared approach. And I just wonder to what extent the issue of who should cover the costs of SLARC recommendations was discussed before the committee started its work.
So I think that our understanding, Chair, was that from the brief that we were given, that this was a joint commission, as Jane has set out, and therefore the implementation of any of our proposals would be jointly considered and agreed. It was we firmly believe that we were working to a date that would allow our proposals to be incorporated into the local government settlement for 24-25. Now, it did become evident that that wasn't going to be possible round about December time when the report was practically finished. We thought that there was sufficient detail to allow any preparation for regulation changes to be to commence at that particular point in time. And that's why we continued refining the report up until February. So at the outset, and I think that my two colleagues would certainly reinforce this if either of them want to come in, that our firm belief on the basis of the timescale that we were asked to follow was that the affordability was really key and that this was something that would be considered jointly by COSLA and Scottish Government.
Thanks very much. Does anyone else want to come in? Additional? David? You don't need to work your microphone.
Thanks, Convener. And it's really just to reiterate the point that Angela excuse me, has just made. In fact, the committee first met in April 2023. And looking back at the minutes of that meeting, there was discussion on that very first meeting when the committee was setting out its terms of reference and its remit and how it approaches its work around the timescales for work towards the completion of the statutory instrument, and that had to be done by November, which then enabled a forward timeline towards April 24 for implementation. So there was an understanding from meeting one, and bear in mind as well, Convener, the committee met 28 times in total and had several similar discussions throughout the lifetime of the 14 months that it was convened for. But it was our understanding clearly from meeting number one that that was the timescale and the purpose we were working towards at that point.
Thanks very much for that detail. Jane, do you want to come in on that in any way?
Thank you, Convener. I think in terms of the interactions that COSLA have had with our colleagues in Scottish Government, it was our understanding that the cost of this, the implementation, would not be left to local government alone. And that was a point that was stressed many times from our presidential team to the Cabinet Secretary.
OK, thanks very much for that. And I'll just go on to a little... So coming back to you, Angela, a little bit of a kind of practical question in a way, that when you wrote to the Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned that SLARC completed its task with only six members rather than seven, as was the original intention. And I'd be interested to understand what the reason was for that and the impact that it might have had on the committee's work.
So thank you. It's quite hard to say what the impact was. I think that the six individuals who were appointed worked really as a united team. For a group of people that hadn't worked together in the past, we very quickly formed quite a strong relationship. We were committed to the task in hand, the commission that we were given, and everybody came with a different skill set. So we utilised those skills to best advantage. So there were two teams that, sub-teams that we then allocated work to. There was a time commitment that we had been given as an indication. I think it was 6 days a month that had originally been the case. I know that on occasions the individual committee members went over that commitment, went over that time scale. But overall, we came in. So I think that we probably compensated for not having a seventh member of the group, and I don't know why that wasn't possible. But I think that the skill set that we had served us really well in the making the recommendations and come to the conclusion that we have.
Okay, thanks very much. So you managed under the circumstances to do a good job. So thanks very much for that. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey with some questions.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, everybody. Angela, could I just turn to you first? In your submission to the committee, you were talking about the Verity House agreement and this whole thing not being in the spirit of that. I wonder if you could firstly tell us, does the Scottish Government normally make separate and specific provision for councillors' salaries, or is it contained within the overall local government settlement?
Thank you. I understand that it's not a separate payment. It's not one of the ring-fenced arrangements that's currently there. I think, though, that given the circumstances and given the commission after a decade, we firmly believed that this would be something that would feature in the settlement in some way or other, that there would be a contribution towards it, or that there would be acknowledgement that there was something in the settlement that would enable councils to increase the remuneration by the amounts that we've proposed. And I have to say, I mean, we did look at this within the current financial circumstances. We know that budgets are really, really tight, that finances across the public sector are really, really tight. So the 5.1 million that we're proposing was something that the committee looked at long and hard. But given the commission was to look at how we remove barriers to public office at this important sphere of government, we felt that that was quite realistic in acknowledgement of the complexity of the roles. And as I've said, I'm sure that there's some in the room that understand that, having served in their local councils.
Thanks for that. Was there some discussion, though, leading up to the Verity House to get this kind of issue embedded within that agreement? And was it rejected? Did you propose it? You know, how did it end up? Is it just not there at all, and it remains a wish that it should be part of the Verity House?
Well, I think, there is an opportunity in the fiscal framework that is part of the proposal for the Verity House agreement to explicitly come together to acknowledge the importance of working with local government to enhance the representation at that level. The report does set out, and David and Martin particularly worked on this, so the evidence that we've gathered in terms of the underrepresentation of particular groups is something that we traced back to remuneration by and large. But there are other issues that are not solely local government, are only apply to local councillors, such as the difficulty in taking very difficult decisions and the role that social media plays. So there are a variety of factors, but our view is that the Verity House agreement and the fiscal framework would be a route whereby a contribution or an explicit commitment to looking at the role of local elected members, not just in terms of remuneration, but also in promoting the work that they do amongst a wider group of the electorate.
Again, Angela, it'd be helpful to hear other colleagues' response to that. Jane?
Jane indicated. Yep, come on in, Jane.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Lily Coffey. So we work within the Verity House Agreement all the time, and COSLA is something we're really familiar with. And the basis of it is an absolute respect between the two spheres of political governance in Scotland. There's a couple of things. I think Angela Leach has pointed out the fiscal framework is an opportunity, but we drafted the Verity House Agreement with our colleagues in Scottish Government on the basis of the principles of the European Charter for Local Self-Government. And there it says that funding for local government must be sustainable. And it also recognises, I said, that the respect that's required at a local level. So both of those, I feel, are quite principled positions of the Verity House agreements, which would add to the argument that this should be something that's included and considered going forward.
So just to finish off on that point, are you saying that the funding for the local councillors should be a specifically set item in any future Scottish Government budget going forward? It should be made specifically separate from that, and provision should be made for it, because my understanding is it's part of the overall settlement.
So, just be really clear, COSLA are not a fan of ring fencing in any way, shape or form. I think it'd be really helpful for Scottish Government to put their commitment into the financial agreement and note that they're including this as part of the general grant that goes towards local government. It's then COSLA's role with our 32 leaders to agree how that's distributed across the 32.
OK. Thanks very much for that. Now, could I just turn to the actual proposal, whether it's a salary increase or not, really, the debate about that. And I think, Angela, in your submission there just earlier, you were saying it's not a pay increase, it's a reassessment. But the figures we have, that is, it amounts to a potential 15% increase reassessment. So could you just explain to us what your thinking is there? Why do you describe it as a reassessment and not a pay increase if it's 15%?
So primarily, we use an annual uplift to look at councillors' remuneration, or have done since 2017-18. what we were asked to do. So the remit that we were given was to look at the role of a modern day counsellor and assess the complexities of that and what was a reasonable level of remuneration to apply to that position. So fundamentally, leaving the annual uplifts to the side, we were looking at an assessment of the role and the value that it then has in our local democracy. And that's the remit that we addressed through the evidence that I've already alluded to, but my colleagues can expand on.
Any other colleagues coming in there? David?
Yeah, thanks, convener. One of the recommendations that the committee made, recommendation 6, was that the committee recommends the salaries of councillors be set at 80% of the median salary of all employees in the public sector in Scotland, as published in the ASH, resulting in an annual salary of £24,581. The 80% figure comes from the activity data that we got back from the councillor survey. The councillor survey, as Jane said, covered every councillor in Scotland, and we got 785 responses from councillors, which is 64% of all the councillors in Scotland replied. So it was a fairly significant response. And what they told us in that was that they spent about 82% of their time in any week on council activities. So that was the matching figure. So we thought the reasonable figure then would be 80% of the median public sector salary. So that was how we arrived at the 24,581 figure.
Thanks very much. Just finally for me, Jane, in your comments as well, I think you said you hoped this, when it's settled, could be backdated to 23,24. What would be the overall cost of that? I mean, I think the councils are worth every penny they get. I served myself for about 20 years in East Ayrshire. So what would the cost of that be, Jane, if we could afford that?
So just to be clear, it was backdated to April 24, so from the start of this financial year. So therefore, the costs are included in the figure that Angela gave you earlier, which was £5.1 million.
Okay. Right. Thanks very much. Thanks, convener.
Thanks, Willie. And now I'm going to go online and bring in Emma Roddick with a question.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. I want to pick up on a comment that Cosla had made, that the timing of the response and related messaging from the Scottish Government has contributed to conflation between the SLARC recommendations and ongoing pay negotiations for our workforce, which is adding a negative perception of the councillor role. Could you go into a bit more detail about why that comment was made?
Jane.
Thank you, convener, and thank you for the question, Ms Roddick. So we've seen that live in terms of the social media response to some of this. Is obviously we're still in pay negotiations with our colleagues in the SJC part of our workforce. They're represented by Unison Unite and GMB, and it'll be colleagues around the room will be very aware of the suggestion about strike action, etc. So it's a live issue. I would say what we would say as COSLA is that we undertake annual, if we prefer to do multi-year settlements, but we do annual pay negotiations at the moment with our trade union colleagues. But we have something separate with our employer. As an employer's, we do job evaluation. And we feel like this is the equivalent to that. So I feel that's not been picked up very helpfully in some of the response from the media in relation to this. So, for example, COSLA's employers hold the job evaluation scheme for our local government workforce, and that workforce will still have their annual pay increase. But every now and then we have to acknowledge as employers that our role has changed, and therefore it's absolutely right that we reassess it with our trade union colleagues and we come to some agreement in relation to how the roles are remunerated going forward. This process has been far more like that job evaluation process than the annual pay increase. As colleagues like David and Angela have mentioned, that pay increase is already dealt with as a separate part of the work with the Parliament. So it's been unhelpful in that it feels like it's pitted our frontline workers against the people who are there to support the services and make decisions around the services they deliver. And in local government, we like to see ourselves as a family. There's very close working between councillors, between managers and between people that are delivering the services. This feels like a really unhelpful thing to have brought together, and it's not something we want to continue to do.
Okay. Thanks very much for that clarity. Emma, do you want to come back in?
Yeah, just very briefly, if that's okay, convener. Would there have been a way to avoid that conflation? What should have been done differently?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. So I suppose it's back to the timescale and the points that Angela made at the start about timing. I think if we've been able to resolve this in December of last year, looking forward to the financial year, then that conflation wouldn't have happened because the conversations wouldn't be happening at the same time. So sticking to the original timescales would have meant we wouldn't be having this conversation today.
Okay. Thanks very much for that. I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosell.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel, and thank you for your opening statements. The cost of the pay of the uplift for ordinary councils would be around £2 million, and the cost of increasing pay for senior councils would be around £2.6 million, adding a total of £4.6 million. Could COSLA provide more details on how they see this being funded? And I know Angela obviously touched on the fact that the thinking behind it was that it would be in the government settlement. And Jane, you did mention that you stressed many times to the Cabinet Secretary. And I think you said you've met 28 times as a committee, was that right? It's just to get some more detail behind this, that was there any promises made at the time? How did you feel that it was going to be, whether it was going to be in the settlement, whether it was stressed to the Cabinet Secretary, what were the responses? Just a little bit more detail to say that how this is going to be funded.
Thank you. I'm happy to pass for causing a hand over to my colleagues in SLARC for their own interactions with Scottish Government. So as it started off absolutely in a joint position, it remains in a joint position. We agree the principles behind the recommendations and we want to take them forward. COSLA have been really clear with our colleagues in Scottish Government and with the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Local Government that we couldn't possibly cover the cost of this, certainly not on our own. And we've made that point a number of times. We understand the financial situation Scottish Government are in at the moment and the constraints that are on top of it. We would just note that for what looks like a fairly small amount of money, it's going to have a huge impact on councils who are cutting services because of the financial constraints they're under. So very hard for those councillors to go ahead and award themselves this job evaluation. So I would say it's been mentioned a number of times and our position's been clear all the way through.
Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Chair. In terms of the engagement with the Scottish Government, we started off in April and it was very positive and there was a very good atmosphere of trying to make things work to the timescale that we'd agreed, and we had that very specific commitment to get the report completed by November so that any potential uplift could be included as part of the SI and the negotiations for the budget. But it became pretty clear by sort of the late summer that you could even sense it, that we were slipping down the list of political priorities for the Scottish Government, and that attendance was a bit less consistent from officials from Scottish Government. COSLA officials, I'm not just saying this because you're here, Jane, but the COSLA officials are absolutely superb throughout the process and were very supportive of our work. But the crunch point really came when the council tax freeze was announced and the messaging from the Scottish Government then was completely different in terms of the timescale that we'd originally agreed was just not going to be met. So I think that was probably, was that September, October time last year?
Great, thanks very much for that. When did you start in April, roughly? Like towards the beginning or towards the end?
The beginning.
The beginning of April, yeah. So you also kind of started at a time where there was a changeover in leadership in the government and that might have had an impact. Pam, you have more questions?
Yeah, that's right.
Thank you, Convener. Martin, you've just mentioned, obviously, you could see that they weren't attending government officials and relationships were changing. Did any of you voice that to the Cabinet Secretary? Was anything written to them, emailed to them to say that, you know, you aren't attending or, you know?
Yeah. So there was a lot of attempts to try and engage with them, different officials, and I know that there were quite a few changes within the department as well, and they've got their certain personnel issues and people being absent and changing roles. So we didn't really have that consistency of support that we would have liked and would have hoped for. But even taking that into account, it was pretty clear that certainly certainly by the time the council tax freeze was announced, it was going to become very difficult for us, because we were still on track in terms of completing our work for November, but it became pretty clear that even if we submitted to the minister by November, it was very unlikely that it would be considered in time for the budget negotiations.
Thank you.
Thanks, Pam. Actually, Angela has indicated she wants to come in as well. Angela.
Yes. Thank you, Convener. And just a couple of points on that. I think that the affordability, as I just said, was something that the committee thought long and hard about. We're really mindful of how it could be funded. I think that on the face of it, 5.1 million does sound a lot, but when we look at the total budget for local government, it's 0.04% of the Scottish budget, the Scottish local government budget. So it is really modest, again, given the timescales that over which there's been that gap. I think, firstly, the committee's previously taken evidence on barriers to elected office at a local government level. And our evidence has shown that remuneration is a barrier. The other barrier is the inability or the reluctance that local government has to award themselves, local government or local councillors, any assistance. We heard when we did a review of governance that they really were at pains not to increase any admin support that they had that might take a bit of the onus off their work, because they were aware of the importance of putting as much as possible into frontline services. So while we recognise across the piece funding is really, really difficult, a demonstration on a overt commitment to saying this is a sphere of government and local representation that is important in Scotland and that as a system we want to be part of that. So not just so much the funding, but really, really considering how best do we encourage people to stand in local elections and get that broad representation. And that can't be done just by people who are in that sector, that part of the system on their own.
Thanks very much.
Thank you, Convener. Angela, I just want to obviously repeat back, echo back. Absolutely, I think representation is so important in communities, especially like being one of the first women of colour coming in with COOCAB, but also one of the first Indian women. It took a long time, 2021, and I think it's important that we spread that through our council councillors as well, making sure that they represent the communities in the right way, having the right people as councillors. So I absolutely agree with you. My next question is around if the Scottish Government refuses the request to pay for the SLARC recommendations, is it COSLA's view that regulation should not be introduced early next year? And I know we did talk a little bit about timings, but...
Thank you. Through you, Convener, thank you for the question. We're really hoping that Scottish Government don't make that refusal. I think that'd be really, really unfortunate. As I said, there's a huge body of evidence behind why this is important, a number of acknowledgements in the room about the fact that we all accept these our findings are accurate. So when we know that that's the case, that this is an absolute representation of the reason that people are not stepping forward into political life, we would really hope that Scottish Government don't refuse to pay this. I think we've got the Verity House Agreement. There's opportunities for Scottish Government and local government to come together and to find the right way forward through this. But I suppose just to emphasise, and you'll have seen this in your own communities, local government is so up against it in terms of finances. We're losing our ability to deliver the services we want to the people that rely on us. And if we're asked to cover this ourselves, this will only either lead to that this won't be implemented and therefore we'll continue to have a very restricted group of people making decisions in our communities, or that will impact further on the services. And from the councillors that I know and work with day to day, they will always put themselves last and put the services first. So this means that the recommendations of SLARC would not be implemented.
Okay. Thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin.
Yep. Thanks, Convener. Good morning. There's a question around the methodology around the recommendation on remuneration. You've linked that salary recommendation to the 2022 ONS data. Now, I appreciate that, you know, during the course of your work, you expected the government to lay regulations for April next year, but the government have made the recommendation that they would not implement until the 1st of April 2025. Given that, from your perspective, unexpected time lag, I just wonder whether you would be providing an updated recommendation, perhaps not limited to a strict financial number, but maybe even referencing a recommendation to the most recent ONS publication.
We, as a committee, we are stood down, so we're not, I suppose, in a position to make any kind of further recommendations in relation to that. But just to say, the 2022 data was the most recent full year of data on which we based our recommendation. So given, you know, what you've just said, it would make sense that whenever that was being considered, if it was for a future year, that it was based on the most recent year, which may well be 2023 by that point. So it would be logical to do that, but our committee's not in a position to do it.
Okay. Just on that point as well, about the length of time it has been since the last convening of SLARC, that was one of the things that we thought would be useful, was to have a SLARC assessment, so to speak, every term, so that it doesn't get so out of date before. But with the 80% of ASHE marry up for councillors, we thought that that would be an appropriate link at the minute, and that that would be based on up-to-date figures as well. So that is the hope that the Scottish Government would include that thinking as part of the SI.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks. Fulton, would you like to come in?
Yeah, thank you, Convener, and good morning to all the panel, Angela online as well. I wanted to ask a wee bit about the work was done in terms of the recommendation of the uplift or the reassessment, a bit like Willie Coffey, whatever we'll call it. Can I firstly say I declared my interest earlier, but I can firstly say I think it's very welcome recommendation and overdue. I mean, I think that the pay for councillors has increased only minimally since I was a councillor, since I first became a councillor actually myself in 2012, so it's very much overdue and I do welcome it. But I wanted to ask something that came to my mind while the discussion this morning has been ongoing. I wanted to ask what you found in your assessments and investigations around about the role of councillor being a second job, and often that's through necessity. Most councillors I know actually have another job, whether they say the council job, the second job, the other job, is neither here nor there. They usually have two jobs. But what I wanted to ask was, did you undertake any analysis on what impact the uplift reassessment might have on this? And I mean that in both sides of the coin. So firstly, which I think we've already talked about, is do you think that that it will take away the low pay aspect of being a councillor being a barrier, and more folk will be able to go for it? But I suppose conversely for that, do you think that with the reassessment the pay goes up to what we could call a high enough level where it more represents a fairer or a normal, in inverted commas, wage, that some people would feel unable to do their other job, mm-hmm. and therefore, in effect, act as a barrier as well? Hope that kind of makes sense, what I'm asking. It came to me today and I've just quickly put it together, but I just wondered if that came up in any of your discussions.
There's certainly a balance, I think, and our survey reflected that. So I can quickly go through some of the figures for you, if that's helpful.
Yep.
42% councillors said that their council role was full-time, but more than half of them were employed elsewhere, either full-time or part-time.
Yep.
So I guess what maybe folk are doing is almost kind of balancing or juggling these two different calls on their time. Some people... We did get some comments of people saying that they did a full-time job and the role of a councillor on top of that, which is kind of one and a half full-time roles, if you like. But certainly I think the sense was that people were balancing that. And also a sense that while they were doing that with the current level of remuneration, they couldn't give up a full-time job because they couldn't afford it, especially younger councillors as well, who've maybe got other financial commitments, like mortgages and so on. But however, the increase may well have been able to tip people more towards taking on the role more, as I feel like, as a full-time role
and maybe shifting from either a full-time role to a part-time role or away from a part-time role itself.
What you're saying is absolutely spot on about the balance to be struck, because there were some respondents to the survey who said that they didn't want the role to be considered full-time because they wanted to continue with their professional life outside of elected politics. So there were some respondents who said that, but the vast majority of folk who did respond who said they were working said that they would like the councillor role to be full-time, but they had to work out of necessity just because of the level of remuneration. The other thing which was completely overrepresented in those who gave an answer was the amount of councillors who worked for other politicians, parliamentarians, and we even had like senior councillors whose remuneration was at a level that they had to have other employment, and the only other kind of fully understanding employer was another politician. And we did have a discussion at one point in the committee about the quandaries that can come from that, particularly, for example, if your employer is taking a position on one issue, but you might, as a local elected member, feel differently about another issue, how that conflicts with your decision-making. So we would have liked to have explored that further if we had time and the potential impacts that it had, but it was we did have to strike a balance, because you're absolutely right. There was some people who were keen for it to be full time if it was remunerated properly, but there were others who responded saying that they liked the fact that they could do it part time and still have their career.
Yeah, thanks very much for those answers. And I should just reiterate what I said in my opening is I very much welcome the proposed uplift. I think it makes a lot of sense, and as I said, it's very much well overdue. Jane, you talked to me a couple of times in answering other questions, and I think in your opening statement about the possibility of people being pitted against each other within the council around this. So I wanted to take that a wee bit further. Do you think there's any risk at all, depending on the final decision around this, that around how it's going to be paid, that we could be left in a situation where... And I don't think it's set up for that just now, but do you think there's a possibility where we could be set up in a situation where actual local authorities end up making the decision on this on an individual basis, and therefore what you could have is X amount of local authorities agreeing to the uplift and X amount not? Or do you think that that won't happen and it'll either be that it goes ahead across the board or not?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the question, Mr McGregor. I think that is a risk. Individual local authorities have their own responsibility around well-being for all their elected members, and they'll be taking that into account. Not all local authorities could even begin to cover the cost of this. As you know, as I said, and we've referred to it already in our conversation, the impact on their finances is so much right now that that's something they couldn't take on. So therefore, you may find that some local authorities implemented it and some didn't. And that would really, I think, exacerbate the different experiences of people that are trying to be councillors in this country. And I think it'd be a real shame if the councillors that are working in some of the smaller areas, for example, are the ones that aren't able to achieve an uplift that lets them to look after their own well-being and maybe drop other things they don't need to do because of the way the finances are. So I think it's a risk. It's not something as COSLA we would encourage, but every local authority have their own responsibilities in this, right? So it is possible.
Okay, thanks. Fulton, just to say that Angela indicated she wanted to come back I think maybe your earlier question. Angela.
Yes, thank you again, Convener. And it was in relation to Mr McGregor's first point. I think in addition to the points that David and Martin have made and Jane, it's probably important just to reiterate that these recommendations don't sit alone. We made a series of recommendations, some of which went beyond the remit, but they were there intentionally because these were observations. These were based on the evidence that we had gathered during that 9 months where we were working with a variety of partners. So So the remuneration per se for an ordinary councillor is going up, I think, quite modestly when you look at the complexity of the work that they do and the level of decision making that they now have. They're very much there for the well-being of local communities and looking at improved outcomes for local communities, as many of you know. So that was really why some of the other recommendations, such as the bandings, looking at a review of the bandings and removing the banding for Band A in particular, was thought to be important. Now, I know that only applies to senior councillors, but it is a reflection of the level of decision making that some of these positions have. We also are proposing an increase in the senior roles for the smallest councils, and that was an attempt to spread the load so that there were more that could benefit from slightly higher remuneration, but recognise the complexity of the work that they're doing. And the other two that I would just flag are the review of governance, which we've proposed, that each council should undertake a review of the governance arrangements to make sure that people can participate as well as they possibly can in any new administration. And I think that is really important if we're thinking about a rich diversity of people coming forward. And finally, is the point about the admin support. Now, I recognise that some of that is within local authorities' gift, but I also recognise, and the committee recognise, that that endorsement that these things are important by, you know, Scottish Government would go a long way to taking some of the sting out of some of the decisions that local authorities would have to make.
Thanks very much for that. Just, I wonder if you can, somebody from SLARC could clear up something I've got in my head, which I think I picked up when you came in previously, which was around disconnecting this recommendation around remuneration from an actual hourly rate and moving it to more of a similar to an MSP. It's like this is what MSPs get paid. There's no hourly rate. Can you? I see nodding heads. So maybe Martin, you can come in and tidy that up for me.
Sure. So we felt that it was almost a parity of esteem in terms of being an office holder and an acknowledgement that actually being a councillor will require you to do some weeks where you're doing 60 hours and other weeks perhaps you'll be doing far fewer. So we had to make the call somewhere, and in terms of the average number of hours reported by councillors, it came out at a 0.8 hour a week. But that was things that we specifically attributed to being a councillor, because we were also very careful to delineate the elements that the public purse shouldn't be reimbursing people for, or particularly their in-part activities, or potentially optional duties. We were focusing really on what we saw as the core remit of a councillor. That figure that came up with was on the basis of the evidence from the council survey. So it was to try and have that kind of parity of esteem that you are an office holder, and it's an acknowledgement of that it's not a 9-to-5, it's not a, some months will be very busy, some weeks will be a bit quieter.
Mm. Okay, thanks, that's very helpful. And Willie, I believe you want to come in on this as well.
Thanks, Kavira. Martin, you talked earlier and touched on the subject about time off for public duties. You kind of mentioned that being one of the issues in the survey and so on, and I well remember my own time in East Ayrshire where it was nigh on impossible to perform a role as a councillor with 10 days a year allocated to me by my particular employer at the time. This is governed by UK legislation, yeah. As I understand it, but it defines it. It doesn't define a framework for what reasonable time off actually is. It just says reasonable.
Yeah.
So if a councillor doesn't think it's reasonable, they're effectively in a dispute with their employer. Is it time we tried to set a proper framework for that and for the government to specify what it thinks reasonable time off is to carry out public duties of a councillor?
Yeah, I think that's a very good idea. With obviously employment, and it was the Employment Rights Act which governs it, and well with the remit of the councils and Scottish Parliament. So I would welcome that certainly, and it would certainly help make it much clearer what people are entitled to, because it's not just being an elected member. It can be other things as well, such as jury duty or other public services. So I would very much welcome that. Yeah.
Thanks very much.
Thank you for shining a light on that. I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us. I wanted to return to the letter Cosler sent after the Scottish Government had responded, which mentioned the Moorhead review in the Republic of Ireland. And so with that in mind, just wanted to know what experience you'd looked at as a committee as well about how recommendations are funded and how the Irish government responded to the recommendations and took forward a funding framework for those, and if any research was done. Given the main sticking point, I think we're all now clear on, is just how this will be funded or sharing that funding. As I mentioned, your letter, Jane, maybe bring you in.
Thank you, Mr. Briggs. We identified the Muirhead review as a good comparison. I suppose we're still really hopeful that the Scottish Government will come and support the recommendations we've jointly agreed to accept between COSLA and Scottish Government. And I suppose it's the sheer body of evidence that our colleagues on SLARC brought to this that I think is really vital here. So while we identified the Muirhead review as an example, and it was really about the way the national government had responded to the local in that aspect. I do think the body of evidence that our colleagues in SLARC have brought in terms of the Scottish example is why we're really keen that that's taken forward compared to, if like, just picking up somewhere entirely. I don't know if you want to come in.
We did make comparisons across UK nations, Republic of Ireland and other European countries as well. The Irish one that you cite is an interesting one because the councillor salaries, I think, were upgraded on the back of the review in 2020, and they pay just under €30,000 for a councillor now. But there's been a further study done, I think, just this year, which says that actually even that's tight. That's about €25,000. So that would be the current payment in the Republic of Ireland would be slightly above what SLARC has recommended for Scotland this year.
Yeah. And in terms of the whole conversation we're having around funding, is there a priority you think within that, if we have the Cabinet Secretary coming in next, the uplift for councillors, would that be your main priority rather than senior councillors? If there is a negotiation to now take place ahead of the budget around what money can be found for this, that £2 million for that uplift, would you say that's your priority rather than £2.6 million for senior councillors? Because it's quite clear there's maybe a stalemate now being reached between government and councils on this. So just wondered for you as a committee, what priority you think is the most important going forward?
That's not something that our committee looked at, Mr. Briggs. We looked at the overall question of affordability within the remit, and certainly as you see that we've recommended two slightly different solutions for senior councillors and ordinary councillors, I'm going to use that phrase, but we've not as a committee considered what the kind of relative merits or priorities of those groups should be. We've looked at all 1,200 plus councillors in Scotland, looked at their different roles and recommended on the basis of the whole group.
Yeah. Okay. Sorry, Jane, did you want to come in?
Thank you, Mr. Briggs. So I don't think COSLA would come down and say one group of councillors over another is more important. What I would say is recognising that we have a lack of diversity amongst the people who are working and standing as councillors in our communities. That also is the case in terms of our senior councillors, in terms of the decisions they'll take and the strategic direction they set for their area. So it's as important at that level as it is at the level of the ordinary councillor, though we'd all say I don't know what an ordinary councillor is because they're so busy and they do so much. So COSLA would like to see the recommendations for all councillors taken forward. I think it's about Scottish Government discussing with COSLA what we can do to make sure that happens. Every year that goes past that we don't address this, the democratic deficit gets wider.
Okay, thanks
very much. And Fulton, you want to round us off the final question?
I'm okay, Convener. I think it's been covered and the questions I wanted to ask have been covered.
I think so too.
Thank you.
Yes. The final question was, what would you like? What would the next steps be? And I think, Jane, you really just kind of nailed it there. Wanting to see the recommendations being fulfilled. Yep. So thank you so much for coming in, and Angela for joining us online. I think that's been very helpful. I'm going to now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a change of witnesses. Thanks. We're now joined for our second panel this morning by Shona Robson, who's the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Local Government. And the Cabinet Secretary is joined by Scottish Government official Fiona Campbell, who's the Local Government Strategy Manager. And I welcome the Cabinet Secretary and Ms Campbell to the meeting. And before we turn to questions from the committee, I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement.
Well, thanks very much, convener, and I don't want to take up too much time before we move to questions, but I just wanted to say a few words. Firstly, I want to thank Angela Leith, the convener, and all the members of SLARC for their time and work on the issue of councillor remuneration and the report that they've produced. Also grateful to COSLA officers who supported the committee in its work. I also want to put on record my thanks to all serving and former councillors for their work. Councillors are key within our democratic system, and they do play a valuable part in local decision making. And we all know it's not an easy role to deliver, and I'm grateful to those that have chosen to stand in the past or are considering standing in the future. SLARC was reconvened by the Scottish Government at the request of COSLA to undertake an independent review of remuneration and local authority bandings. And a key focus was on whether levels of remuneration reflected the responsibilities of modern-day councillors and were not barriers to elected office. The Scottish Government's response to SLARC's recommendation report was published on the 5th of July, earlier this year. In that, I indicated that I was happy to accept the majority of the pay and structural change recommendations and would make regulations early in 2025 to implement these. A key factor for the timing to implement the recommendations was that the initial report was not published until February 2024, which of course was after the Scottish Government and individual local authorities had agreed and set their budgets. It was therefore not possible to consider the cost implications and take these into account when making spending decisions this financial year. Convener, I also need to be upfront about costs. The Scottish Government does not and has never provided funding specifically to meet the costs of councillor salaries. This has always been a matter for local authorities. Councillor salaries and associated expenses are paid from each authority's annual allocation agreed under the local government settlement. However, I have indicated to the COSLA presidential team that I'm happy to consider the cost of implementing the recommendations as part of discussions for next year's budget and settlement. And I'm sure we'll talk more about that during the session. There are some shared recommendations for Scottish Government and COSLA, for example, promoting the role of councillors in the severance resettlement payment. And I've accepted most of these either in part or in principle, and I'm happy for my officials to work with COSLA to give them further consideration. As I said earlier, councillors play a key role in Scotland's democratic system. Pay is only one barrier to individuals standing for election, and we need to look beyond this to review and remove other barriers to office. The COSLA Barriers to Elected Office Special Interest Group is, I think, critical in this area, and I know it's moving at pace. Councils themselves have a role to play, for example, looking at timings of meetings, reviewing any administrative barriers that may, albeit unintentionally, be impacting on participation. So I look forward to seeing the outputs from the group, and I've asked my officials to support this work where it's appropriate for them to do so. And I'll end there, Convener, but just briefly repeat again my thanks to the committee for its work and to the past and serving councillors for their contributions.
Thank you very much for that outline. I've got an initial question. It's kind of around timing of the SLART report. Mm. And obviously that was published in mid-February. But what we just heard from the previous panel from SLART Committee and COSLA was that they actually could have published it sooner. They could have published it in December, but they were under the impression that they had that time to kind of continue refining it. But so there's that piece of the puzzle. But also, I think something that we're interested in is that the report was published in mid-February. Why did it take the Scottish Government until July to publish its response?
Well, I think as ever with detailed reports with a number of recommendations, which some have quite far-reaching implications, not just on a cost basis, that those had to be properly looked at and analysed, responded to, and that was done. I mean, I think if we'd rushed out a response without looking at the detail and implications, then I think we would equally have been potentially criticised. To be frank, though, if we had the report and then the response out that would have landed around the time of the pay review, the pay policy being published, I suspect that might have been an unwelcome scene setting for what has become quite a series of difficult local government pay negotiations. I'm not sure there would have been a great perfect time for this to have been published in that context, because there's always going to be comparisons made about what the uplift, the proposed uplift here is compared to potentially that of local government staff. And I just don't think you can avoid that, to be honest. And I don't think it would have mattered when it was published. That was always going to be a comparison. I think the important thing is what we do now. And I think there is room and scope for agreement to move this forward. I know that there's been a kind of troubled history when looking at councillor remuneration. I think it was back in 2011 at the first attempt that didn't really get very far. I think what will be important, though, and let me just be really clear about this, is cross-party support for this, both at a local government level, but also in here, because regulations will require to be supported for changes to be made. So if this is a priority, it has to be a priority on a cross-party basis. And, you know, that is the way it will be taken forward. And that will be the only way it will be taken forward.
OK, thanks very much for that. Mark, you've got some questions.
Yep, thanks, Kamina. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. You've touched on it before, just about the impact on industrial relations between local government workforce. COSLA had said that, I'm quoting, the timing of the government response and related messaging has contributed to conflation in between the SLARC recommendation and its ongoing pay negotiations for our workforce. I just wonder what your response to that, and has that made negotiations over local government staff pay any more difficult because this discussion has been going on at the same time?
So, as I said earlier, I don't think there would have been any perfect time for this report. So if it had been published earlier, it would have been the opening gambit for some of those negotiations. So it would have been right at the start of them. Potentially, you could argue it would have then set the framing and the floor for those discussions with local government workforces to take place. So I don't think there would have been any ideal timing in that respect. I also think, looking at the negotiations in detail, obviously two of the three unions now having a very much welcome their acceptance of the offers made. I think there was a whole range of other issues that the local government unions were looking for in terms of pay progression for the lowest paid and all of those. I'm not sure that the SLARC recommendations were centre stage of all of that. I think there were a whole load of other issues about negotiation around those pay issues. And, you know, I think the fact that now two out of three unions have accepted shows that enough progress was made, particularly on the pay progression for lower paid, to the satisfaction of two out of the three unions.
OK. The other issue I wanted to cover is when you talked about the regulations that the government intend on laying, and we heard from the previous panel and SLARC themselves that they hoped that those regulations would be in place for 1st of April this year. Now, I understand for the reasons that you've given why that wasn't possible. They also stated at the earlier panel that they set the benchmark for their data as 80% of the annual survey of house hours and earnings, whatever it is, at the 2022 level, because those were the latest available figures. So just to ask whether the regulations that you will lay will reflect the latest ONS data, or whether that will fall back on the 2022 figures which were available to SLARC at the time, because they've expressed a preference that that be updated to whatever the latest verified.
I'll bring Fiona in on that specific point in a second, but on the principle of when, so, well, I don't think anybody failed to notice what I had to bring to Parliament 2 weeks ago, and I think in the context of the in your position this year, I think the idea of, you know, trying to, you know, backdate something in year this year would just be impossible, incredibly difficult. And, you know, going back to the optics that you mentioned earlier on, I just don't think that would be at all sustainable. So the focus for me is what can we do from April 2025 onwards? And Fiona, on the point about the uprating.
The regulations will lay in January. We're looking to use the 2024 SLARC recommended salaries and use recommendation 11, which proposed a mechanism for an annual uplift. So we'll apply that uplift mechanism to the 2024 salaries for new 2025 salaries, which will be the ones that will go into the regulations. And that's based on ASH data as well. So if the ASH data showed an increase of, say, 5%, we will uplift the salaries by 5%.
Yeah. So essentially you'll update a 2022 figure for a 1 year increase, but you'll appreciate that, you know, that will be applied in 2025, which is 3 years later than the 2022 data. So just wonder what the rationale is on just applying a potential 1 year uplift to figures that are 3 years out of date.
I think it's just we're taking the SLARC recommended figure that if we had been able to lay regulations in 2024, that would have been the SLARC salary, and you would have gone into the annual uplift anyway. So we're just doing that two stages in one set of regulations.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Very much. Just before I bring in Pam Gosar with her questions, what we in the previous panel we were discussing the kind of timing of things and kind of the relationship, working relationship between SLARC, COSLA, and the Scottish Government, and they started their work in April 2023, the beginning of April 2023, and said that it was very positive, very engaged, but actually quite quickly. Towards the end of April, things changed, and that timing was around the the announcement of the council tax freeze. And I just wonder if you could share with us a little bit about maybe what happened there. The kind of relationship was good, and then they've got a sense that there was less engagement from the Scottish Government.
Well, that is not something I am aware of, to be honest. I was under the impression that the work on SLARC was positive, getting on with it. I think where the difficulty arises is who pays for this, who funds it. That was the difficulty in 2011, and that is the difficulty now. Are you saying to me that, you know, is the council tax freeze decision, you know, been a bit of an issue in a whole load of discussions with COSLA? Well, yeah, it has, right, because they don't agree with it. So it has surfaced in many discussions with COSLA, but was it an issue that got in the way of SLARC? I don't think so. I think the bigger issue is we all agree on most of the recommendations. It's then about how it's funded and the precedence of, you know, the understanding. There was never any commitment at all given that Scottish Government were going to fund this. But in an attempt to be helpful, I think to try and move it beyond where it got to in 2011, there is a route there, but it has to be a cross-party route. And you can understand the reasons why I'm saying that, because in the current climate, money is tight, and therefore there would have to be a cross-party agreement that this was a priority. I think there's a strong argument in advance of 2027 to try and set the ground for encouraging new people to come in to serve in local government. I'm not for it, as I said in my opening statement, I don't think remuneration is the only issue, but, you know, it is a barrier. I don't disagree with that at all. I think it's one barrier. There are many others that I think politicians around this table will fully understand that are difficult. So I think if we collectively agree this is important, then we collectively agree it's important in terms of the budget.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Pam, you've got a couple of questions.
Yeah. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and good morning, Fiona. It is clear that SLARC was set up as a joint review by COSLA and the Scottish Government. This was also echoed in today's earlier session by COSLA Chief Exec Jane O'Donnell. What was also mentioned in the evidence session was that the relationship between COSLA and the Scottish Government started positively. However, as time went on, especially around April, attendance fell from the Scottish Government officials, especially around the time when the council tax freeze came in, with relationships decreasing. Therefore, could the Cabinet Secretary explain why is the Scottish Government now saying that it is up to the local government to fund the salary changes for councillors, which account to a total of £4.6 million, when it started with a joint partnership with the Scottish Government and COSLA.
OK, thanks for that. So COSLA asked for SLARC to be set up and the Scottish Government agreed because we recognise there's a remuneration issue. So COSLA asked for it to be set up, Scottish Government agreed. The council tax issue, I don't recognise that having delivered something different in terms of the recommendations. I mean, the recommendations are positive and have been, you know, largely accepted by the Scottish Government. So the council tax issue, I don't see what has changed in any of that. I don't think it would have changed any of the recommendations and the report that popped out at the end of that piece of work. It is as it would have been whether or not there was a council tax freeze, in my opinion. And as for the funding of it, at no point has the Scottish Government said in SLARC or anywhere else that the Scottish Government would pay for the remuneration of councillors. For the very point is they never have. It's never been something that Scottish Government has paid for. It's always been paid for by local authorities themselves out of the settlement. And the same issue arose in 2011 when it was clear, you know, when the Scottish Government made the position clear at that point that any uplift and change to remuneration would have to be funded by local government. And at that point, there was no agreement, so nothing changed. At this point, there could be agreement, but, you know, you'll understand, Pam, as a, you know, an opposition spokesperson, the importance of moving this forward on a cross-party basis, because if the local government groups, which are multi-party across the leadership groups in COSLA, if they all agree this is a priority for the local government settlement, when we're negotiating, we get into a lot of detail around the local government settlement, then, you know, that for me is a signal that there is cross-party support for that. The regulations in this place will require cross-party support. So we need to all be on the same page if this is to go forward and money is to be found. Because what I'm bluntly not going to do is to fund this in the face of opposition from other parties. I'm just not. So my challenge is, if this is a priority, then let's take it forward on a cross-party basis. I think it's a good report. I think it's as good as it, whether or not the council tax freeze had happened. I think it's a good report, and it's a report that has a lot of merit, but we need to agree on a cross-party basis.
Thank you for your response, Cabinet Secretary. Yes, I agree, it's a cross-party decision now, but what my question referred to was clearly about then the relationship there was between COSLA and the Scottish Government, not cross-party groups. So hence why I'd asked you the question that I got some earlier evidence from, that asking the question that basically the relationship broke down. Now, it's very important that we never have that relationship kind of breakdown. We've talked about it earlier in other sessions in Verity House agreements. But when it's come to this, the evidence from COSLA's chief exec clearly stated earlier on that the actual engagement dropped from officials. Is that something you were aware of?
Well, this was also the pre-election period, remember. So there would have been issues around Scottish Government officials' involvement in a number of forums because of the pre-election guidance and all of that. So that had potentially had a disruptive effect. But let me be absolutely clear, I don't think the decision on the council tax had any bearing on the report that emerged from SLARC. I think it would have been exactly the same report with the same recommendations, whether or not the Scottish Government frozen the council tax or not. I think it's a good report. The question, though, for everybody now is how are the recommendations funded going forward? And I think we can get into a positive space about that, but it will, as I say, need to be done on a cross-party basis.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'll go on to my next question. Given the Scottish Government obviously agrees with the pay uplift recommendations, which you've said it's a good report there, how would you see that the £4.6 million is met? Is the Scottish Government suggesting that it would be individual councils to meet that money? And I personally know, because I have spoke to out of you know, 32 councils, 31 chief execs, and it's clear that they are struggling right now to meet essential spend as well. But also we've heard from the evidence earlier on today that, you know, there'll be less people out there now making decisions, councillors, it could mean that. But also it could impact services, because services may have to be cut if local authorities have to find this money. But last but not least, I would say, especially being a minority person myself from the ethnic background, that we will not attract key representation from people from disabled backgrounds, people from basically ethnic backgrounds, but also, very important, more women, because they find that, we've heard today, that Slack said, and COSLA, that it's a barrier for women to come into the profession, and salary is one of the areas. So if you'd like to probably say a little bit about that, but also you had mentioned there may be other things, and it's not just salary that's a barrier, so that'd be good to hear from you.
So I think that last point is key. We know that that there is a there are barriers to women and people from minority ethnic backgrounds, and you know, a number of people are underrepresented in elected local government elected members, and that should be a concern to all of us and something we should collectively want to address. Remuneration, I think, is part of it, but also our need for flexibility. Sometimes the I guess something we're all very aware of, just the abuse in public life is hard, and it puts people off, and it puts people off coming in to serve in any elected forum. So I think we have a need to address all of these things, and the special interest group that is being worked on through COSLA, I think, is really important, because it will help, I think, to try and address some of these issues. In terms of the point about money and essential spend and who pays, well, we're all facing those issues, I think, given what I laid out to Parliament about the in-year position. The position of the Scottish Government is no different. We are under severe financial constraint. So how do we take this forward? Well, there are various mechanisms within the local government settlement that this could be accommodated within. But I go back to my previous point. It would really need to be done on a cross-party basis, that all of the represented groups within COSLA would need to make it clear to me, as part of the budget process, that this was a collective priority that they wanted to see funded. Now, the mechanisms to do that, there are various. You could top slice an element of local government settlement for it. But you can understand from my position that this will not be universally popular to do this. And you can already see some of the media commentary about it. So if we're going to do it, we need to do it collectively to take it forward. And given that local government is multi-party and we have a collective interest in taking it forward, then we need to try and do that in a way that takes the politics out of it. So I'm very happy to discuss with COSLA and the local government leaders what that looks like. Do I think we can get there? Yes, I think we can, but it will require everybody to step forward to say, you know, this is an opportunity for 2027 to really lay the ground and make it a more attractive proposition. But it can't just be Scottish Government's responsibility to do that. So, you know, I will go. I'm very keen to have those discussions, and I've written to the presidential team offering to take these forward as part of the budget negotiations.
Okay, thanks. I think I need to clear up a little bit of our time scale. Then we've got some different Aprils going on. Council. So just to be clear, so SLART began its meeting in April 2023. The council tax freeze, which impacted relationships, happened in October 2023, and the SLART and then SLART reported in February, which was 5 months before the UK elections. So just wanted to get clear on that, because I think we were starting to talk about different Aprils there. And I want to bring in Willie Coffey with continuing questions around SLARC's recommendations.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. It's just to stick with the issue about who pays, which is certainly confusing me this morning. I've always understood that who pays our local councillors is part of the overall settlement mm-hmm. for local government. You've mm-hmm. said that yourself. But there seems to be a suggestion, or a developing suggestion, that somehow the government should separate that out.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm certainly getting that sense. Mm-hmm. I don't know whether our colleagues got that this morning, but in asking our witnesses before that if that's what they were asking for, I don't think they were agreeing with that. So mm-hmm. where does this come from, this who pays? You said a wee moment ago the difficulty is who pays yourself. So could you just explain to us again, Cabsec, mm-hmm. who actually pays the salaries of the local council?
So it is local authorities who pay, and there has never been any precedence of the Scottish Government funding salaries, salary uplifts for councillors, and there was never any indication during the SLARC discussions from us. Certainly, we never gave any indication that that would be the case. And what has emerged since SLARC has been a call from COSLA and leaders that this needs to be funded beyond what local authorities have in their budgets. Now, that would be a new way of doing things, and it was an issue that really got in the way of any progress being made back in 2011 for the same reasons. And I think the difficulty is this is not going to be a universally popular move, and therefore if it's the right thing to do, then it needs to be done very much on a cross-party basis. And that's the point I was making, because it steps out with the norms of how this is done. And it's at a difficult time. It comes at a time where finances are really tight in local government and Scottish government, and it you know, has already garnered some negative media portrayal, so it's something that you know, needs to be handled carefully. But I absolutely recognise what SLARC are saying and what members around this table have said about the barriers. And looking towards 2027, remuneration is clearly one barrier, not the only ones, but it is a barrier. And if we collectively decide this is a priority, then that will be, I would imagine, seen as a priority by all concerned as part of the budget process.
OK. When the government, if the government agrees and sets these regulations for those salary levels, they must apply across the board in Scotland. Is that the case? Or is the government saying that councils can apply those salary uplifts, or must they apply them?
So the regulations would give authority to apply them. Technically, could an authority, if it was down to local authorities to fund, I guess they could decide not to.
The regulations set the new salary levels.
So it would be difficult for any local authority. So essentially, if Parliament agrees the regulations, which could only be really agreed if we've got the money in place. So I guess it's what comes first. Does the agreement around the funding? Well, there would have to have been agreement around that before the regulations. The regulations would be in the new year. Yeah. So one would have to follow the other.
I'm just trying to remember what Jane from COSLA said a moment ago, and we can check the official record, but she said something like, if the Scottish Government doesn't agree to pay this, then COSLA might not be able to implement these pay mm-hmm. changes. So on the one hand, you're agreeing that they can set the new pay levels for the councillors, but on the other hand...
Well, what they're saying is they want us to pay for it. They're saying they can't afford it, and they want us to pay for it.
And ring-fence that, and basically... Is that ring-fencing back then, if you did?
Well, I think it would... That would... Well, they don't... Well, I think they're instinctively against ring-fencing.
I know.
But It would then be a case of what mechanism would you use as part of the local government settlement? Would it be top sliced? Would it be... these are all details that would need to be discussed. But you know, there are ways of doing it if political agreement can be reached.
And there wasn't any broad discussion about that whole issue then during the whole course of the SLARC consideration?
The Scottish Government have never said or given any intimation that there would be a change of assumption of how this is paid for, given that it's never been the case. So nothing was said that was in any way changed that or gave that impression.
Okay. Finally from me, just in your own response to the SLARC report, you say that you recognise that this is a year after the committee's suggested date for implementation. Mm-hmm. And so on, and then you say we will account for this delay when setting the salaries to be paid from the 1st of April 2025. Could you just expand on what do you mean by that? Exactly?
So what that refers to is what Fiona answered earlier on about the uplift mechanism to make sure that there's no detriment of it being a year later. And then there would be a mechanism going forward to make sure it keeps pace with inflation and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. So it would take into account that this was being implemented a year later.
And it takes into account a possible backdate to...
Well, it wouldn't be backdated to 2024. No, it would start from 1st of April 2025. I'm very clear about that. And I think the idea... Well, so I think this would be... This will be difficult enough to get agreement on, and I think the presentation to the public as well, as you know, it's an ask. I don't think the public particularly have politicians' salaries at the top of their list of priorities. So, but the idea of doing it for 2 years from the 1st of April 2025, I'm just not going to agree to from the offset, so that's not happening. What we will discuss is whether we can find agreement to implement this from the 1st of April 2025.
OK, that's clear enough. Thanks very much for your responses to those questions. Convener.
Thanks very much, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet
morning.
Secretary, and your official as well. I wanted to go back to Verity House Agreement, because mm-hmm. it's been raised, mm-hmm. and in response, Angela Leach said of the Scottish Government's decision not to fund the recommendations that she didn't think does not seem to be in the spirit of a Verity House Agreement. I just wondered how you'd respond to that specifically.
Well, I don't agree at all, actually, because, well, Verity House is about partnership and respect for each sphere of government, I think, is the is something that's very important for COSLA. And responsibility lying for respective roles and functions. So, for example, it's not about central government funding all local government costs. We don't fund all teachers' pay or local government pay per se. We've made a contribution to it, but we don't fund it all. These are the responsibility of local authorities. So it's where the balance lies. And I think on something as contentious, if I can use that word, as this, the responsibility has to lie on a cross-local government, cross-party basis, because otherwise I just don't think this is going to fly. So I think the spirit of Verity House is actually about partnership and trying to find solutions. I've said I'm willing to have the discussion around the budget to see if a solution can be found. But that's going to require compromise and give. But I'm certainly willing to have those discussions.
Yeah, thank you for that. You'd mentioned that there's no precedent for this, but I wondered in terms of the Local Government's Scotland Act of 2004, where ministers obviously made regulations to provide for local authorities to make payments for severance payments for councillors who weren't seeking re-election when we moved to STV to elect councillors, whether or not that is the precedent for taking this forward.
It's a bit of a stretch, though, isn't it? It was a very specific thing 20 years ago. A bit of a stretch. I think that the assumption has always been that local government funds the remuneration of its of its elected members. That's always been, and you can see why, because, you know, it's quite a contentious area. It's something that you could flip and say they might not, on a normal course of events, probably wouldn't welcome Scottish Government interference in the remuneration of councillors. But what we're talking about here is a significant change to remuneration. And so I do recognise the challenge here. And so I think it needs to be a shared responsibility. It's not something I think that would come along very often. So it is a reset, and it would be something that would need to stand the test of time, and it would be something that would need to be part of a kind of wider package and presentation to really try to encourage the points that Pam Gosselt was making about how do we encourage more people to come into local government. And there's a opportunity with a line of sight of 3 years away for 2027 to do a number of things that could really encourage more people. Remuneration is only part of that, but it is part of it, but it's not the only thing.
And can I just ask, finally, if government's looked at ways of reforming this beyond what the recommendations outline? Mm-hmm. You know, Westminster have IPSA to look at theirs. We've got our corporate body. Mm. I take your point. No one will see politicians' pay as a priority, but actually it's quite clear that councillors' pay just hasn't kept up and is now a barrier. We know that from all political parties and representatives who are now looking towards leaving councils in the future because they just can't actually to make this stack up for themselves and their families. So just wondered, so we don't end up back in this circumstance in the future, whether or not there's a reform there which we should look towards.
There may be. I don't think that was particularly looked at as part of the SLART recommendations. It may be that it's more of an issue for the special interest group. I think the mechanism of uprating will help to avoid councillor pay falling behind again and being back here in 10 years. Is there other wider reforms in local government? Well, I mean, how long have you got? We could sit here all day and discuss what that might be. But I think SLARC was, it was set up for a very specific reason, and remit was quite tight, understandably. So it probably didn't venture into some of the wider reform issues about the number of councillors and roles and responsibilities. I think that's a whole other discussion. Is it one that might have merit in the future? Maybe, but I think we've got this here in front of us and here and now that we need to focus on resolving.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Kevin.
Miles Fulton.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and to Fiona. Just picking up on that point about the public perception of politician salaries, I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary thinks there's any more we can do as a Parliament and on a cross-party basis, as you mentioned before, to kind of educate the public a wee bit more on that, because I think that MSPs are very well paid, MPs are very well paid, but let's be frank, councillors aren't. But I'm not always sure that the public understand that. Many times I'll see on social media or people come to my office and criticise councillors and talk about their big, massive salaries. When they're actually told what the salary is, it's often a surprise. I'm sure everybody in this room has experienced that. And I wonder, is the Cabinet Secretary think there's anything more we can do? Because I think you're right, it won't be popular, and I can already write the headlines for the next stages now, about it, while we may all be agreed. But is there anything that can be done to so that people know that what councillors actually do get paid and they don't get paid the same as us?
I mean, there's maybe a wider... I wouldn't focus it on pay particularly, because I think you're probably on a bit of a hiding to nothing, to be honest, but... There is something about the role of councillors and just the wide variety of work that they do and the responsibilities that they have. And many of them are trying to juggle other jobs at the same time and all of that. So there is something, and it could be part of trying to encourage more people to think about standing in local government in the run-up to 2027. I think there's something about us elevating the role of councillors, the work of local government, what they do and why it's important, and the need to have a wider variety of people stepping forward. I mean, in the old days, it used to almost be seen as a kind of voluntary thing that only, you know, those and such as those and retired people would potentially ever enter into. Now, we're moved on mm-hmm. from that, and we see more women, younger people, but it's still really low compared to other spheres of government. And so there is a perception issue and a practical barriers potentially. So I think when the special interest group reports on the wider things that are barriers, there's maybe something for us collectively. I don't know whether the role of the committee as well, we might have something, a role to play here as well, of us looking at ways of trying to put some of that out there, to start a bit of an awareness raising around the role of councillors and the importance of the work that they do. So I would certainly be up for that.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Moving on, I also wanted to say that there was some commentary of the last previous panel session that we were in. I would probably disagree with that, some of the commentary that's heard today. I don't think, in my own opinion, it can be described as slack, saying there was a breakdown in communication with the Scottish Government. There was a comment made by one of the last panellists saying that they noticed a tailing off of attendance at meetings around about a specific time. But I actually got the impression, it's my first day on this committee as well, so picking up this particular piece of work, I got the impression actually that it was a really good piece of work, mm-hmm. collaborative work, with more or less everybody being on the same page, with the only really main contentious issue, which has been the focus of both panels' discussion, has been around about where the funding will come from. But as I say, that is just my opinion. Mm-hmm. But on that note, Cabinet Secretary, do you think there's any risk of some individual councils choosing to pay the increase and others not? Causal in the last session did say that this was a possibility, and obviously we wouldn't want a postcode lottery situation. So what more do you think we can do to work together to avoid this? And as the main opportunity, as you've already said, through perhaps the budget negotiations?
Mm-hmm. I mean, on your first point, I have to be honest, it's the first time I've actually heard there was any breakdown of anything in what was said in the last session. Just not my understanding at all. Now, I wasn't at the meetings, to be fair, so I have to be really clear about that. But I don't get the sense that there was any difference or change to the report or the outcomes that would have happened whether folk were attending all the meetings or not. I think the report is the report, and it would have been the report no matter what, because it's a good report. It's very clear in its recommendations. I think SLARC have done a good job. So then it's the question, as you've alluded to, what now? The regulations, Fiona said earlier on, would set the level of salary. So all of that, of the agreement around how it's funded, has to be all sorted in advance of that, clearly. Otherwise, we'd be passing regulations that folk haven't agreed to how they're going to be funded, and that's just not the order to do things in. So we do have to get into sorting the how, and that has to be a compromise that is discussed through the budget process. I've said I'm open to that, and we should look at what the art of the possible is. I'll have some requirements from the government's perspective, and that is that this is a collective decision and a collective priority.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. And one more question, if that's okay. On the issue of severance payments for councillors who lose their seats, the government have said that you need further consideration on this particular recommendation. Just wondering if you could expand on that, Cabinet Secretary, where the government's thinking is with that.
So it does require further consideration because, well, one of the fundamental questions is, would it apply to existing councillors or only those elected from 2027? Because those who stood previously stood without that being an expectation. And I don't want that to be taken in the wrong way. It doesn't. It's not about the principle of it or not, but it is a fundamental question. Would it apply retrospectively or would it be forward-looking from 2027? And that is important because the cost is significant beyond what we've just been talking about in terms of remuneration. So I think there that would be something that would have to be really carefully thought through. And it might be in the push to attract a wider group of people coming into local government from 2027 onwards, it might be quite an attractive part of that package going forward that could be a basket of things. So I think that is really why that needs to be discussed further, because the cost goes up significantly from just the remuneration costs.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Gina.
Thanks very much. And we're now going to go online and bring in Emma Roddick with a question.
Thank you, convener. Just kind of want to round things up by recognising the concerns that have been expressed by COSLA and SLARC. What does the Cabinet Secretary see as the next steps in this process?
Yeah, so I think the next steps are for the budget and for some genuine negotiation around the budget. But for me, there is a step that I will require, and that is some reassurance about the cross-party support for this move. And that needs to set the tone, I think, for the local government settlement around if this is seen as a priority, it needs to be everybody's priority. COSLA and local government is made up of all parties represented in Parliament and independents as well. And I think there has to be, you know, a stepping forward of everybody to say, despite the heat and the, you know, which there will be, we are all agreed this is a priority and we want to make sure in our discussions with the Scottish Government as part of the local government settlement that this is seen as a clear priority by everybody. And I don't think it's unreasonable for me to ask for that.
Thank you.
Okay. And that... I was going to say that concludes our questions, but Miles has some point. Yeah.
Thank you. Just a question I put to the previous panel. Mm-hmm. The £4.6 million, which the total cost being outlined, I think for most of us, ordinary councillors are the £2 million, which has been brought forward. Mm-hmm. Is there a priority for yourself, Cabinet Secretary, if you're splitting what is a £2.6 million additional cost for senior leaders? The word ordinary, I don't think we've particularly liked this session, but just wondered where your own thinking is on that for any future sharing of costs or negotiation.
Yeah, so I think this is the sort of territory we get into in the budget negotiations as part of the local government settlement. I think it's a good question. I think the position of ordinary councillors for me is a priority because it's, you know, it would be the main thing that anyone thinking about going into local government would be looking at, because there would obviously be a number of years before they would become a senior councillor. Well, unless there was exceptional circumstances, and in most cases you come in and you serve as an ordinary councillor, a backbench councillor, however you want to describe it. So there is a priority there. Now, if I guess what you're alluding to is there a split there around who funds what? Is there some compromise? I think these are all the things that I would really quite welcome getting into with local government to find a pragmatic way forward. And I really hope, you know, we can, because, I you know, there's genuinely an issue here and everybody accepts it. And it's just, you know, are we willing to collectively just, you know, grasp the moment and agree that we need to do something about this on a collective basis?
Okay, thanks.
Thanks for asking that, Miles. And I think that one of the things that came up in the previous panel, I think it was Angela talked about that, that we do have that imbalance of representation, which I think has been mentioned mm-hmm. this morning. And regardless of whether the person is a senior counsellor or a counsellor, they're at a time where we don't have that proper representation, and we're in a time where very difficult decisions need to be made. And so it's so important to have that representation mm-hmm. at all levels in the council mm-hmm. so that the decisions of how the budget spend falls out actually supports the people that we've been talking about in terms of the barriers to mm-hmm. local elected office, so that we have people in the space that are people of colour, mm-hmm. Disability, women, single parents, all that kind of thing. We really have to change that makeup. Mm-hmm. I think we all agree that.
Yeah, I mean, well, you can't be what you can't see is a phrase I think is very you know, pertinent, and we need to see local government represent and look like Scotland, and in some parts of the country it doesn't, and that's for all the reasons we fully understand, and you know that's not unique to local government. We've still got work to do here. There's a lot of work to be done at Westminster, but the, you know, without a doubt, if you look at the level of women's representation, for example, it's much lower than another parliamentary in other spheres of government. So there is an issue there, without a doubt, and I think there's an opportunity to do something about that. That's not just about remuneration, and I think that's an important point to emphasise. It's about so many other things that when someone is making a decision, is it for me, is it not for me, that goes through their heads. Mm. So partly it'll be about work-life balance, other commitments, caring responsibilities. Some of it is about, well, frankly, you know, toxicity of our political discourse, social media, the media portrayal of politicians, and, you know, we all know what that can be like, particularly as women. And that puts folk off. I have spent a lot of time trying to persuade women that I know to stand in local government and other spheres, and it's hard because they'll say, well, I just need to look. It doesn't take me long to find abuse directed at female politicians, female councillors included, and it has a particular flavour. So there is something about our body politic more generally that we need to try and sort out. It's not easy. I don't have a list of answers here, but it's hard, and it does put women off, and others, but women in particular.
Yeah, and certainly that's something you mentioned, that the review group could potentially, I think, in response to Fulton McGregor's questions, could take forward that.
Yeah, and I look forward to seeing what they recommend. Yeah.
Shifting of public perception. Yeah. But I think at the end of the day, really, remuneration is quite an important mm-hmm. piece for people's consideration. Mm-hmm. But thank you so much for coming in this morning and giving evidence. And now I briefly suspend to allow the Cabinet Secretary to leave the room before we move on to the final public item on the agenda. Thank you very much. Okay, the next item on our agenda today is to consider the following negative instrument: Valuation Proposals Procedures Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024. And there's no requirement for the committee to make any recommendations on negative instruments. Do members have any comments on the instrument? No one has any comments. Okay. Is the committee agreed that we do not wish to make any recommendations in relation to the instrument? We're agreed. Thank you. And we previously agreed to take the next item in private. So as that was the last public item on our agenda today, I now close the public part of the meeting.